Hey guys, Brent Hull Build Show, talking today about the Greek Revival, right? Have you been to Greece, right? Have you been to Athens? Have you studied all that, right? Why is it called Greek Revival? What is it a revival of? What's going on? Why do we fall in love with the Greek Revival style? In fact, it's one of my favorite architectural styles. I think Greek Revival houses are beautiful. Why is that? We're going to study it today. Part one, the history of Greek Revival in America. Come join me. So, Greek Revival style, right? Why is it one of my favorite styles? I think because it's charming, it's strong, right? It is simple, right? It's well-defined, it's proud, right? The Greek Revival style in America starts in the 1830s, 1840s, and usually lasts until the 1850s or 60s. Remember, this is all part of a series that we're doing on architectural interiors. First Georgian, now Federal, now Greek Revival. So next time we're going to be getting into Gothic Revival and the Victorian era, and that's a whole nother ball of wax. But we start to see some of that taking place in the 1840s. Now, what is some of that? Some of that is the industrialization, right? You begin to have steam-powered planing mills at this time. Now, typically, 1860 in the Civil War is when you have pre-industrial versus post-industrial. I'm going to move it back a little bit because I've got a flyer in my office that shows steam-powered planing mills from the 1840s, right? So we know it was happening earlier than that. And so that industrialization and that stuff that's going on there is making a difference in how we build. Now, I want to give a shout out to my friend Jacques Lavette. He's an architect in Atlanta. Good friend. We've done some work for him. He's just done a video at the ICAA on the introduction to Greek Revival. Now, he does a much better job than I could do, so I want to send you over there. Go to classicist.org/articles, and you'll see his video there on the Greek Revival. It is a really good introduction, right? And one of his early slides compares Roman Doric versus Greek Doric. And you'll see all the different styles and all the different details. It's a great introduction. I encourage you to watch that. In fact, all those videos over at the ICA are great teaching videos talking about architecture and design. So if you're into that, go there. Now, why do I have the map of the Ottoman Empire up here? Well, it's a fascinating story because what was happening in the world at that time is that men from England were going on these grand tours, right? We talked about Robert Adam last time with the Federal style and his discoveries at Pompeii, right? Well, there was a guy named Stuart and Rivette, and there were two guys, and they wanted to go study the Greek temples, right? Well, so if we look at this map, Greece is over here, okay? Rome is over here. When those people were coming down from England, they were going through France, they were going through Paris, and they would end up in Rome. But really, they understood at this time that the Greeks and the Romans had kind of worked these things together, and no one had really studied the Greek temples. Why is that? Well, because we have something called the Ottoman Empire. Now, if you go back to a history class, you'll remember that Rome, the capital of Rome, was originally here, and then it moved over to here, to Constantinople, okay? Became Istanbul. This is part of Turkey today. The Ottoman Empire came over and took over this whole area, right? And so in the 1760s, right, the Ottoman Empire still controlled Greece. So it was very hard to go there, right? It was very hard to travel there. So no one had. Stuart and Rivette were the first ones to kind of get permission and go into Greece to study these temples. And they wrote a book called The Antiquities of Athens, where they cataloged and dated these buildings from Greece, and it just became this huge stir. Now, that book was published in 1760s, okay? I just told you that the Greek Revival style starts in 1840, right? So what's going on? Why is that? Well, you gotta understand that at this time, the passage of design went very slowly, right? Remember that Palladio wrote his book in 1570. It wasn't until the 1700s that it really had an influence in the country houses in England, right? So design takes a long time to travel. We don't have Instagram in that day where you see these designs and all of a sudden it's everywhere. So design was very slow. Now, the guys who did pick it up, and you'll see this in Jacques' video, are the different pattern book authors in America. And our most famous one of my heroes, is Asher Benjamin, right? And so he becomes, and these American authors, Menard Lefevre, Asher Benjamin, I've got Shaw's book here, become these very influential books on Greek Revival and the Greek Revival style. Now, if we just look at these pictures, right? And then in Jacques' video, he talks about the difference between the Roman Doric and the Greek Doric, right? The Greek Doric has no base, right, at the bottom of the capitals. Notice how the flutings are built differently. So you begin to see these stylistic differences between the Greeks and the Romans. And you'll see that if you watch his video. But I just want to show you a few pictures of kind of what was in America and what was Greek Revival and why we recognize it as that, right? This temple front is kind of the first giveaway, right? That you have this temple front, much like the Parthenon, right? Where you have this temple design. This is very Greek Revival. You see this on banks, you see this all over, this kind of design thing. And the simplification of these details and in the architecture. This is the fireplace from that room. Notice how simple this is. This style as very monolithic. Now, why would that be monolithic? Well, they were so inspired by what was going on with these Greek temples made out of stone, okay? They're now designing and making things to mimic that stone look. So you don't have a lot of detail here. It looks very heavy and strong. Now, one reason why I think the Greek Revival is popular today is because it's a very clean line design, right? It's very American, it's very early, but it's also simple. It's not over the top. People like that today. And so I think that's one reason why it's popular. So anyway, you have these very simple and clean details, right? This other Greek Revival house, little temple front here. Notice there's no pilasters here, but that temple projecting pediment that comes out here. Notice those details. Notice the way this is laid out. And you'll see that in the design books from Shaw and from different things like that, where they actually are designing these entrances, right? To have the columns, right? Here's our columns, there's their columns, side lights on either side of those columns, right? This six panel door. I mean, this is where that design idea comes from, and it's very simple. Now, if we're gonna execute this, right? If we're gonna execute this design, it's not really difficult, right? It's boards, you know, mitered together and glued together. It's simple pilasters. Simple clean lines again. Now, if we dig into a little bit more of the details, one thing Jacques reminded me of is that HABS, okay, Historic American Building Surveys, okay, you can go, it's the Library of Congress, it's online, you can go look at HABS and type in Greek Revival, and it'll give you all kinds of things to look at that are Greek Revival, interiors and exteriors. Here's a little house here. And if we dig into this entry, right, and look at these details and these moldings, we again see this, these Greek Revival shapes. Now, Kukin Brothers is a molding yard I designed some classical American moldings from. Now, here is their Greek Revival casings, right? And they've got a whole line of Greek Revival styles. But you notice that this shape, right, is very similar to this, where you have these large back bands, right? This egg-shaped, elliptical-shaped back band here, right? All these shapes, simple and clean, right? This is a very simple and clean profile. Now, looking at these moldings, right, we start to see some details. And one of the reasons I want to do this is I wanted you to really become master builders and understand the different shapes. Now, look at this down here. I've got the three different moldings we've been talking about, right? We've got the Georgian molding, a Federal molding, and now the Greek Revival. And with this Kukin line, right, we see them all in those same sizes, about a 5-inch molding, right, big casing. There's a smaller version for windows or a smaller version for a smaller house. But notice the way these shapes change and then how it communicates change. Because really, all that's happening with the Greek Revival style is our shapes of our moldings have changed, become much simpler, right? This step here is just a square step. where it's a little cavetto there and it's a little cyma there, right? And on the back band, we have this big projecting Georgian. We have the cutaway for the Federal with the bead. And then we have this kind of slanted with that little fillet step in the Greek Revival. Now, and I've told you guys, I want you to be able to start picking and choosing molding designs. And so I come back to the same chair rail, right? Remember, we started with a kind of a Federal shape, right? Federal shaped chair rail, the way it looks like that. And you can put on a different Federal chair rail there. We've got the Georgian here. Just all I'm doing is I'm changing these shapes again, right? And recommunicating, and I can do the same thing with the Greek Revival. So I'm looking at this molding. I'm looking at this molding detail, and I'm seeing this shape here. I recognize this Greek Revival. I milled it and cut it off, and now I've got a pretty cool little Greek Revival chair rail, right? And so now I've got that slanted shape in there, which is very popular, and that panel mold can go in a ton of different places. That panel mold can go indoors. It can go, you know, at the top of a capitol, right? You can start picking these shapes and designing, right? Because really, you know, I can walk into an historic house, not see the front, not see the outside, and start looking at moldings and go, oh, this is from this period, because they're all different. They all have distinctive kind of characteristics that make them unique and tell a story, right? Because that's really what this architecture and stuff is. It's about telling stories. Now, you have to get, as Jacques points out, after like 1826 or 1827. This one's from 1841. So this Practical House Carpenter was one of Asher Benjamin's book that he started writing like early 1800s, and a number of editions, and his styles changed. He became very influential in the Greek Revival style. Now, if you go back and you look at some of his drawings and some of his pictures, look at some of these details, right? Look at the simplification of that mantle, right? To build that mantle, there's no bed mold in there. There's no cymation, right? There's just this flat board. Remember, that's monolithic. Remember, we want to be stone-like. So their designs end up being very modern, right? That could go in a modern house right there. And so you begin to see how these styles are transitional, and how, you know, if we want and if we have an ethos of being simple, clean cottage styles, right? But we want something a little bit more modern. We want something a little bit more architectural. The Greek Revival all of a sudden becomes this great design motif, great design jumping off board where you can design from. Because that mantle we were just looking at had no moldings in it. It was all square, sharp changes in shapes. So that's the Greek Revival style, right? That's the history. This is part one. A lot of great details and a lot of great things to learn from. I want you to understand that history. I want you to understand where it fits, right, in America as we're growing and changing, right? Because next we're going to study Victorian, and it's complete departure, right, of what we're studying here. So good stuff, good history. Follow me on Instagram and Facebook. I'm Brent Hull. Thanks for watching.